potter throughout the century, particularly in the 19th century in rural America, was that he was performing and producing functional, utilitarian, everyday use utensils. For the most part, storage vessels, they were the most common product for most potteries. Things like crocks and jugs and jars, but also everyday use utensils, mixing bowls, pitchers, milk pans, pie plates, butter churns, all common products that came from the potter's wheel. This is still an era long before mass production techniques, and so the potter was using a potter's wheel, which hadn't changed actually for millennia. Potter's wheel has been in use continually for the last 4,000 years at least, and the technology really hasn't changed very much. The process is the same. Taking the raw clay, centering it on the wheel, which is what I'm working on right now. And in Western New York, there were some potters that utilized this clay for functional pottery as well. And so these would be the crocks and the jugs and the jars, tablewares, tavern mugs. They were all shaped on the potter's wheel from this clay. These pots are being prepared to be loaded into the kiln for firing. These have not been fired at all. There's no bisque fire at this period in time. So these are raw, unfired, air-dried pots. This open doorway to the kiln is the only access we have to the wear chamber. And I'll start loading way in the back of the kiln. This kiln will hold about 300 to 350 pots, depending on the size of what's been made for this particular load. I really need to be in the kiln in order to reach the shelves. And so it's just one pot at a time. During the course of the firing, we'll burn through about 4 to 5 face cords of hardwood. Once the kiln's hot enough, we're right around 2200 degrees, we can start the salting process. By throwing the salt, just about 1/4 cup at a time, right into the firebox, it starts to vaporize. It's so hot, the salt becomes a gas, and it works up through the kiln as a gas, and the sodium from the salt combines with the surface of the pot. It actually fluxes or melts the surface of the pot. And over the next hour or so, we'll run probably maybe 50 pounds of salt through the kiln, just a little bit at a time from both stoke holes, and it will continuously build the glaze layer on top of the pots. And I can see now that some of the salt vapor is starting to work through some of the cracks in the kiln and starting to flow up through. Now that we've salted the kiln for about an hour or so, it's time to check the glaze and see what kind of glaze development we have. So I have draw trials in here. They've got just a little bit of a hole in them that I've cut in. I just have to catch the hole and then fish it right out. This is the same clay the pots are made out of. And so they've developed the same glaze that the pots inside the kiln have developed. So it's a matter of checking. That's about 2200 degrees. It's got a nice glaze finish on it. It's nice and smooth, which means we've developed quite a bit of surface. And the typical texture is on there, the little droplets of glaze, the orange peel texture. We've waited patiently for 5 days for the kiln to cool, and we're down probably maybe 400 degrees or so. The bricks are still warm to the touch, but it's time to get this door down and start looking at, see what kind of pots we have inside. There's the first one out. This one's got a nice little blush down here at the bottom from a little reducing atmosphere, but the color looks really nice. The glaze is nice and smooth and consistent. Firing with wood, there's so many variables going in. You can just ruin the pots, or you can just make really beautiful pots. This looks like a very, very nice load.